Well, to help us understand the impact and significance of China's reform and opening up, I'm joined by Gordon Houlden. He's the director of the China Institute at the University of Alberta, as well as a professor of political science and an adjunct professor of the Alberta School of Business. Thank you for joining us.
It's a pleasure.
So considering where China was back in 1978, how would you describe the country's economic achievements over the past 40 years?
Well, they are truly extraordinary. At the time when I first went to China, actually immediately after the policies were launched, people's living standards were barely adequate. There certainly wasn't the surplus to buy luxury goods, or travel, to buy automobiles, there were pockets of extreme poverty. China at that time had the largest number of the absolute poor in the world. All of that has been changed.
And you actually have a chance to meet Deng Xiaoping, the principal architect of China's early economic reform. Tell us more about that.
Well, I can remember as if it was yesterday, the first time that I met Deng Xiaoping. Of course, it wasn't me alone meeting him. I was a junior diplomat. Our prime minister was visiting at the time, Pierre Trudeau, and I was accompanying and taking notes. But I was riveted by Deng Xiaoping's comments. He was already an old man at 83, but full of ideas, full of vigor, and he led a team of people who launched this remarkable reform. And I think that the numbers that were cited earlier of the people lifted out of poverty doesn't really give the full feeling, because if you knew the individuals and saw how their lives changed, it's even more impressive. People who could maybe not afford a bicycle or were saving to buy a bicycle, who can now travel abroad and have even higher expectations for their children's lives.
Now, you have a lot of first-hand experience in China. What stood out to you the most about your time there?
Well, I think I was always well-received by the Chinese people. And here I'd make a point. I think that the government, under leadership of Deng Xiaoping and other key officials, set the framework for development. But I would underline that, in my opinion at least, it took the hard work of hundreds of millions of Chinese to put those policies into motion and to achieve the results. So it really was a collective effort of the Chinese nation led by Deng Xiaoping and then subsequent leaders. That was absolutely critical. And there's a few things in Chinese culture helped a lot: respect for education, thirst for education, and a desire to better their own lives, but also to better the state of the nation. It was a collective effort, and it was a privilege to see that firsthand.
And certainly not a small feat to get an entire country on board when it comes to doing something as bold as opening up. So how do you think the reform and opening up policy, how has that changed the lives of ordinary Chinese people?
Well, food was rationed at the time. Most even essential items were rationed. People had enough to eat, just barely, but there was no surplus. People wore their clothes until they were worn out. There was little mobility within the country, let alone abroad. All of those things became possible, and even quite literally, color came into people's lives with choice, of consumer choice. People had a role in their daily lives of choice and selection that was not present before. There was an informality and a liveliness that crept into society in those years right after the policies were announced. Although I would note, it took time. When the central government formulated these policies and began to spread them through the country, not every region developed at the same rate, and that's still true. That's a challenge for the current government. But everyone became better off, some perhaps faster, some regions faster than others. But the movement was and has been sustained in an upward direction, even if there are still pockets of poverty and challenges that still need to be met.
And how do you see that development over these years transforming the global economy?
Well, there is part of the challenge, of course. When China pursued a policy initiated by Deng Xiaoping of opening the outside world, things get a lot more complicated. For one thing, China is now very integrated into the global economy. It's the world's leading trading country. But that also means that it's heavily influenced, unavoidably, by what happens in other countries. If their economies stall or go into recession, that has an impact on Chinese manufacturers, on Chinese factories. And that's true in financial terms as well. When you're part of the world, you're influenced by the world. And that's presented a whole set of challenges that I think China is managing quite well, but they can never eliminate the twists and turns. And I think that's why one of the key words that have come up in recent discussions this week of the Central Economic Conference is risk management. And risk cannot be eliminated. It can be managed and modulated. And that will take, I think, very supple and flexible policies going forward.
So just quickly, for people who are really trying to understand China's journey and its impact on the world, what would you say should be the biggest takeaway?
Well, I would, for a moment, ignore the big numbers. China can always generate big numbers, and those numbers, 700 plus million of people lifted out of poverty, but that doesn't really capture the reality for a child, let's say a young child in 1978, whose educational opportunities expanded, the universities expanded, the quality of teaching, the quality of life, bigger flats, better food, mobility within the country. I think sometimes looking at the micro level, how an individual's life has been transformed, particularly a young Chinese from the 1970s, whose opportunities to choose their own employment, to find a niche that works well for them and yet still aids the collective development of the nation, that I think should not be overlooked when one cites the very large and correct numbers of what China has achieved, which is a parallel in human history.
So now that we have this economic roadmap laid out from China's Central Economic Work Conference, what's your take on where the country's headed with its economic priorities in 2019?
Well, I was impressed by the comprehensiveness of the list, but I can't think of anything more difficult than with 1.4 billion people achieving equal outcomes everywhere. And of course, one of the things that allowed China to succeed so well was letting certain areas like Shenzhen or Shanghai race ahead. But now I think the government correctly realizes it needs to double back, increase productivity and quality of life in some of the areas, rural areas in particular, that have left behind. That's a key challenge. Plus, as China moves up the value chains, there are going to be products and industries that may move to other countries. How to replace those with quality production, higher up the value chain, innovation, the multiple tasks the government is trying to do simultaneously. That's a tall order.
And were there any key changes in tone or direction compared with the previous years that we've seen?
Well, I think one of the things that China, I think, is wisely avoiding doing is simply to go, as the economy slows somewhat, I think largely in response to a slowing global economy, to go all in for stimulus by infrastructure building. That has some challenges down the road, leads to challenges down the road in debt management. So I think the Chinese government, and it's particularly its financial managers have said, we're going to stimulate productivity, we're going to look for new industries that have growth potential, but we're not going to do it simply by priming the pump, which has short-term gains, a bit like a sugar high, but has disadvantages in debt management further on.
So how do you see the deeper tax cuts and the larger fiscal spending helping China manage some of the economic headwinds?
Well, there I think is one of the key things. Tax cuts, both for individuals and industries, is one way to do, as an alternative to infrastructure spending, that has that hope of increasing the motivation for businesses and individuals to be more productive. But as noted, I think, by your earlier commentator, financial risk is there. When you're open to the global economy, that risk will need nimble management going forward. Tricky things like interest rates. One of the things that also impressed me is the emphasis on greater transparency in the financial sector, particularly in markets, stock markets, which, in my opinion, haven't been fully playing their role in Chinese development as yet. That's one of the areas, I think, for reform and growth over the next 3 years of that cycle.
And what about foreign investors? What sort of reforms can they expect to see in China?
Well, I think foreign investors are still see China as probably the most appealing place to put their money globally, but they're looking for new sectors. Certainly not real estate. They're looking for agricultural product, looking for financial sector innovation where they can be whole owners of their companies, or joint ventures where their IP is protected and yet they can share their knowledge and productivity with their Chinese partners. That takes very careful management on the Chinese side. But China now has a lot of IP itself to protect. So I think there can be really strong partnerships using a mix of Chinese IP and foreign IP. Also very much at the forefront in the discussion was mixed investment, where both foreign and Chinese private investors will work in mixed economy, mixed models with SOEs. That could be an area of considerable progress and hope for.
Now, obviously, another headwind, U.S.-China trade tensions. How deeply is the impact of these trade tensions being felt in China?
I think the impact is there, but the full impact has not yet been felt. And quite frankly, as someone living in a third country, it's clearly in the interest of the world that these tensions be managed and diffused and put aside in some fashion. I think the rest of the world is cheering for a solution to this, and I'm hoping that the American and Chinese leadership manage to achieve that. I think the impact is being felt already. Of course, it'll have been more intensely felt in those industries, and there are many which were focused on the U.S. market. The impact will be there already. And of course, pending and hanging is the threat of a whole other $250 billion U.S. of tariffs that could be imposed if this deal is not realized. But there are no winners from that. In my view, it's a lose-lose scenario. Right. Bad for China, bad for the United States, and bad for the rest of us if this deal cannot be realized. I have no idea if the leaderships in Beijing and Washington will be successful, but I believe that we all have a huge stake in the success of these negotiations.
And we did see China's leadership reference the major changes going on in the world, but they also said it could provide both risks and opportunities for the country. Just quickly, how do you see that?
Well, I think there are major opportunities, and quite frankly, growth rates in the emerging markets are faster than in the developed countries. China has broad exposure there already, so those Chinese exports that are not going to the United States but going elsewhere have very bright prospects as well. China is now already an innovation center. China is well past the day when people could say that simply it was copying foreign technology, if that was true. But certainly now, innovation centers across China, in Shanghai, in Beijing, in Shenzhen, and elsewhere, in Guangdong, these new technologies and their application to traditional industries and new industries, be the AI, the internet, the Internet of Things. I believe that the world broadly will be more concerned in future decades with how they can share in Chinese IP and have access to it, will be at least as concerned about that as the risk to their own IP.
Well, thank you so much for all your insights. Gordon Houlden there, Professor of Political Science and Director of the China Institute at the University of Alberta.